They have been planning a vacation for a while, and every time they got ready to go, well, matter of fact, one time when they went, my mom got sick. They had to come back. The next time they got ready to go, she got sick the day before. She'll probably be mad because I'm telling y'all this. She's very private. But this time, the day she got out of the hospital, I was actually in Greenville at a conference, and I got a call from my brother. I'm usually the one the first to know something wrong with our parents. So when he called me, I was like, what? What do you mean? So mom had been sick and in the hospital since that past Monday, and this was now Tuesday, almost Wednesday. So my spirit was grieved. I came back, and God still delivered. Amen. And so the day she got out of the hospital, my dad planned another trip. I say, y'all just don't listen. Y'all just need to have a staycation. So they are doing well. And so here we are. Amen? Amen. The title of my sermon today is Finding Peace in a Chaotic World. I'm going to try to use this mic. Finding Peace in a Chaotic World. I'm thankful today to see my first grandbaby. Oh, you just have to ask, and sometimes they'll answer sometimes. So thank you so much. That gives me hope. Amen. So when we think about finding peace, this word peace, people do so many things. When you think about peace, living in a world full of chaos, confusion, uncertainty, peace seems impossible. However, I came by to tell you today that it is available to us. All right. Amen. Amen. Amen? We're living in some uncertain times. You turn on the news and it's flooding, it's drought, tornadoes, hurricanes. We used to have those when I was younger, but it wasn't as bad, I don't remember. I was talking to my brother, I'm always struggling what to preach. Of course, it starts with prayer. And so peace fell in my spirit. And I was talking to my brother now. He was like, well, what are you preaching about? He wanted to know my topic. He said, tell him about political unrest. It's a lot of that going on. And so he goes on to tell me, did you know that the KKK and the Proud Boys marched last week in Tennessee? So I told him I would put that in there just for him. So on social media, a lot of times you see so much stuff going on. You turn it on first thing in the morning and you see deaths. You see children running away. I remember my grandma back in the day, if somebody died, she was reading an obituary in the paper. Now you just see it all over Facebook. And who would have thought that we would, in our time, not only see COVID, but we saw a presidential attempted assassination. It's been 43 years since that has occurred. And do you know Wikipedia? So if it was a lie, it came from there. It's already been updated to July 13, 2024. Isn't that a shame? The last thing that we can even think about is having peace in this chaotic world. People are always in the pursuit of peace. People pay for apps. I got about 4 or 5 of them on my phone. You can Google how to have peace. You can YouTube how to have peace. Matter of fact, I did. I went to Google and I Googled and I looked how to have peace, and I found several articles. One of them was I found 8 tips to find inner peace. It said, laugh a little bit more, take some nature walks, practice breathing. I'm a counselor, and I'm all about breathing exercises, journaling. But baby, when you're getting attacked left and right, you ain't thinking about no breathing. One thing that was left off that list was God and prayer. C.S. Lewis says, God cannot give us happiness and peace apart from himself. It doesn't exist. There's no such a thing. God is peace. In him, you can find it. So is it possible, I ask you, can you find peace in this chaotic world? Again, I stop by to tell you how you can have peace. So instead of me giving you 8 tips for inner peace, 20 ideas to help you find peace, 3 steps to get your peace, I'm going to share with you 3 practices where you can find peace. Amen. I call them practices because it's just that. What does practice mean? It means that you got to practice it, you got to do it. And if you look it up in the dictionary, it would say that you have to do it often, habitually, consistently. So that's what practice is. So we're going to talk about 3 practices today that will help you to find peace. So I'll say practices again because we got to do it on a regular basis. So nothing that I say matters. It won't mean a hill of beans if you want to pick it up every now and then. We got to do it and do it consistently. So the first thing that I found in my Bible is that you got to rely on God's control. Isaiah 26 says, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind stays on you because he trusts in you. Verse 4 goes on to say, the Lord, trust in the Lord always, because if you trust in him, he is our rock. Amen. So in Isaiah, his audience was Judea, and they were facing political and social injustices as well back then. So that just tells you that the Bible continues to repeat itself. Amen. In this part of the chapter, Isaiah is having a song of praise, celebrating God's protection for the ultimate victory of his people. So that means that we can celebrate as well. Amen. Even though we see all this stuff going on when we turn on the news, we can celebrate because the scripture says perfect peace. That means complete. Amen. That means complete peace. That means that when everything is going wrong, I can still have peace. I can have it even in the difficult times. But a lot of times we don't like to celebrate during the difficult times. We like to cry. We like to hurt. We like to curl up. Amen. But we got to learn how to stand tall because we rely on God's control, not ours. Notice that the promise is perfect peace, keeping your mind stayed on him. So when we're going through things, which we often do, we can think of things right now. We got to rely on God. That means that we believe in his control. We believe that he can do everything he says he can do. We got to believe that his plans are good for our life, that he is capable of handling the situation. Think about Daniel in the lion's den. He continued to do what they told him not to do because he knew, and they threatened him. They said they're going to put him in it, but he knew that God had control. Unlike King Darius, he stayed up all night worrying because he didn't know that God could control it, but Daniel did, and then God delivered. Amen? So as we go through, I only know how to preach or teach how I know how to. So I'm going to give you, after we finish every point, I'm going to say this. As a counselor, when I meet with students, I give them lots of information, and they're overwhelmed. So I always give them like a sheet of to-do lists or what to do next. So what to do next? We said that you're going to rely on God's control. So what do I do with that? Remind yourself that God's character and his promise. Make it a habit. So start with something small that you usually don't give God. Give it to him and see what happens then. So just start. You know, as a child, I looked up to my father. Of course, I still do. And when I had a problem, whether it was in college or wherever, I could just call him and I knew he was going to handle the problem. But as an adult, I know he has limitations. He can't handle all my problems. But I do serve a God that can. Amen. That never sleeps nor slumbers. Amen. So even though our kids look at us and they see mama can handle it, daddy can handle it, no, we really can't. We have to go to God as well. Amen. He never sleeps. He never slumbers. And he's ready to handle whatever situation. So I call it my testimony / confession. I had a job at Aiken High. I worked there for 6 years. I was the lead counselor for 6 years. I loved it, but it was a very stressful job. And I had an opportunity after my 6 year to get the job I'm currently in. But it was one thing. It was great. I was still going to be a counselor, but it was a lot less. Not a lot less. It was a pay cut. And so I struggled with this because I was wondering, like, who goes back down? Most people go up. But I was like, I talked to my husband. He said, we good. Take the job. I'd rather for you to be less stressed. So I go over to this job, and it's the best job I have ever had, I feel like, because it's 3 minutes from my house. My husband said I could cartwheel over there. But I want to tell you, I said testimony / confession. Because even though I trusted God and I knew he was in control, I took the job. I went out and got a part-time job. I did. And that was because of my disobedience and knowing what I have to do with Kaylee and all of the kids and the support that I still give them. I was like, I don't know what to do with this guy. And so a year to the date that I accepted that job, I got a promotion and I had more than what I had before I got the job. So I made a mistake. So I don't want to, we're clapping yes, because God is real and he blessed. But y'all, that's what we do. I took the job, but then I went and got a part-time job. We don't always listen. He has total control. He can handle the situation. One thing I did say with my part-time job that I'm probably getting ready to quit is that I'll never miss church. I'll never miss Bible study, and I'm never going to miss anything that I have to do in ministry. But if you'll have me, I'll do that. But that's, although I think that's good, but it's also to the fact sometimes we just got to stand still and believe that we need to rely on God's control and not our own. Amen? Amen. So the second, I'll say practice. The first practice was to rely on his control. The second one is to rely on the presence of Jesus. John 14 and 27 says, peace I leave with you. Peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives you. Do not let your heart be troubled, and do not be afraid. Jesus was saying this to them because he knew their heart was going to be troubled, but don't stay there. You don't have to be afraid. The verse is a part of Jesus' farewell disclosure, and we're studying that in Bible study, that this was his final teaching, like the Last Supper, that he was talking to them. And y'all, that's huge. I don't know if you missed it, but Jesus says, peace I leave with you. He's getting ready to leave. He's getting ready to die. But yet and still, he thought about us. Amen? That's powerful. I don't know, on my deathbed, would I be telling everybody stuff and trying to make sure you good? I'm going to be a little afraid about me. But that's not what God has called us to do. You're going to have trouble, but don't be afraid. Amen? He's getting ready to be crucified, and he's still thinking of us. Amen. All of the things that we went through, COVID and the country shutting down and all of these things, They're going to happen. And we can believe it when we see it. But we got to know God is in control. How do we know? I said this part was rely on the presence. How do you know when God is speaking to you? How do you know that he is with you? Well, you got to develop a relationship. You got to develop a relationship with him consistently, praying, doing daily devotions, gratitude. Gratitude is not what you think, it's just saying thank you. Gratitude is being thankful when you don't feel like you're thankful. Gratitude is when things don't feel good, but yet I got to say thank you. That's gratitude. And that when you get in the presence of Jesus, you'll have that gratitude. Amen? Amen. God is begging for us to spend time with him before it's too late. Amen. We got to build a person relationship. So when I think back to John and I first meeting and dating, we used to talk on the phone all the time. He might have lived here or didn't live here, but we always was on the phone. And how we built the relationship was when we talked on the phone and we got ready to go to bed, he would say, go ahead, you hang up and have a good night. And I would never hang up. No, you hang up first. You hang up. No, you hang up. That's what God wants from us. Go to bed listening and talking. Wake up in the morning listening and talking. My husband probably think I'm crazy. He probably be, I talk to him so much that he'd be like, who are you talking to? So now I have my AirPods on and I go to sleep and I'm listening to him. I'm talking to him because I need answers. Amen. We got to listen. We got to spend time. We can't just spend time with him on Sunday, on Wednesday. Right. Amen. We got to pick up that book and we got to read it. Amen. 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 We got to set aside a prayer time, not fit it in. When I get in the car, I pray. No. We got to set aside a time. Amen. Amen. Jesus offers us peace. Amen. In different circumstances. But we got to rely on his presence. But we don't rely on his presence if we don't even know what his presence feels like. So how do we get there? Our spiritual checklist. The first thing we got to do is we got to invite him into our daily worship. We got to pray often. Read the Bible often. Cultivate a relationship with him. Seek his guidance and acknowledge his presence. Amen. Amen. As we move through, the first practice that we got to practice is we got to rely on God's control, meaning that when we rely on his control, we know that he can handle the situation even when we got to put our hands in it. He can handle it. We got to rely on it. Rely means to depend on. Then we got to rely on the presence of Jesus. The last practice that we're going to talk about today is we got to rely on God's promises. In Philippians 4, 6, and 7, it says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And here we go. The peace of God will transcend all understanding. It guards your hearts of your minds in Christ Jesus. There's so many promises in the Bible, but most of the promises that are in the Bible are about they're about man, God to man. Most of the promises in the Bible are about what God promises us. So we got to read it to know what the promises are. A promise is not like when we promise, because sometimes I promise and it might be like Nigel say, mama, you promised. Oops, I promise, sorry. A promise can't be like God's promises. It's not always, John, I'm sorry, you made it twice in this sermon. But sometimes the boys, we got a lot of boys, John and I have four together, and then we got nephews, and they love the challenge, John. They love, they just love the challenge. They want to challenge them in a relay race, sports, video games. I bet I could beat you in here and give you $5. They know John not going to give them that money. But every time, they fall for it. So the promises are not like that, but the promises are promises that we can stand on. I remember an old hymn saying, standing on the promises of Christ, my King. standing on the promises that cannot fail. When howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God, I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Amen. We got to stand on his promises. We got to rely. That means surrendering our own desires and believing the truths of him. That takes practice. First of all, we got to know what the promises are. If somebody promised you some money right now, they said they was going to give you some money. You know what time of day they said it. You know what they was wearing when they said it. You know everything about that day. But guess what, y'all? God did the same thing. He promised it. He promised everything that we need. It's in the Bible, but if we don't ever open the Bible, we won't know the promises. Amen? He put it in the book. The video I played earlier says that there is peace in Christ when we learn of him. Feel the love he felt for us when he bore our sins. Listen to the words. Let them come alive. If we know him, there is peace in Christ. If we know him, he gives us hope. And when hope is gone, and it's the last line says, there is peace on earth. If there is no peace on earth, which is not, there is peace in Christ. Right. Amen. Amen. As we start to find our peace and find out that in this chaotic world, is it even possible to have peace? Yes, it is. The answer to the question is yes, it is. It's in the scriptures. Let us commit ourselves to divine peace, allowing it to transform our lives. Right? Allowing it, no matter what the chaos around us, let us get our spiritual checklist. Yeah. I challenge you, one thing to practice. I love accountability. So on your program, on your hand, on your app, in your notes app, I want you to write down what you need to practice better doing. Nobody don't have to see it, but I think I love, like I said, accountability. So I would encourage you and I challenge you even farther to tell somebody what it is. What those things might be, remembering relying on God's control, relying on Jesus' presence, or relying on his promises. That means reading your devotion, praying, meditating. And if I'm talking to you and you don't feel like you have anything to improve on, well, improve on what you're doing more consistently. All right. Amen? So I'm going to make one promise to you as I get ready to close. It's a promise that you can rely on. It's a promise that you can depend on. If you do what I'm asking you to do, you're going to choose one thing and you're going to do it better. You're going to do it more. And I promise you, I pinky promise you, I promise you on my grandma, rest her soul, which I love her dearly, like the kids say, I promise you on the Bible. That's serious. That you will find peace in a chaotic world. If you rely on God's control, you rely on Jesus' presence, or you rely on God's promises. Thank you.
I need you. You need me. We're all.